is like a lost cause. If I were you, I would have turned around and walked away. I would have labeled me beyond prepared, cause I feel like I'm beyond prepared. Oh, but somehow you don't see me like I do. Somehow you're still here. You're the God who stays. You're the God who stays.
Music stops. Holy smokes. Man, people get just uppity and all that. Good morning, everybody. Good to have you here. We're privileged to have you join us here at Way of Hope this morning. We're glad to have you here where we can join together in person and online to worship the God who saves. Amen? Amen. For those that are unable to be here this morning and watching online, welcome to you as well. We want to encourage you again today to let us know that you're here. Make a little comment for us. Maybe tell us where you're at. We're glad that you're here with us in spirit and part of our worship this morning. Also want to say that if you're not familiar with church and you're joining us online either today or anytime during the week, I hope that you'll stay tuned in with us. And I hope that you'll join us again next week as we continue on worshiping God together here and join us as a part of our online worship. And we also encourage you to share and to like and to follow and to do all those things online so that the good news can continue to spread as far as possible. That's what we're trying to do, spread the gospel of Jesus into our broken world. And we hope that you'll help us do that as we continue to preach and to pray and to praise and to just lift up the name of Jesus. So thanks everybody for joining us online. Thanks for joining us here in person. It's always good to see the smiling faces here as we worship. We've been working on the last couple, 2 weeks, last week and now this week, doing some self-examination. And you hear me say all the time at Love Feast time and communion time that we should take some time to do some spiritual inventory, that we should look at ourselves. And the scripture reminds us of that as well in 2 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 5. And I love the way that it's stated in the Message, Eugene Peterson's The Message, because it really is a little more hard-hitting, if you will. 2 Corinthians 13 and 5 says, test yourself, test yourself, test yourself. If you're reading New International Version, it says examine yourself to make sure you are solid in your faith, solid in your faith. Just grab a chair there, guys, and have a seat. It says, test yourself to make sure you are solid in the faith. Don't drift along, taking everything for granted. Give yourself regular checkups. You need firsthand evidence, not mere hearsay. Do you hear that? You need firsthand evidence that Jesus Christ is in you. Test it out. If you fail the test, do something about it. We've been looking kind of internally as Christians at our own faith journey over the last couple of weeks. So I encourage you as we go through this list again, or some of it from last week and the new ones that I'll give to you this week, that you do just that, that you test yourself, that you examine yourself, that you ask yourself and do some spiritual inventory to see if there's evidence of Jesus Christ in your life. So pray with me this morning as we give God some praise today. Father, we thank you again for the opportunity to again gather here to worship. We're grateful, Lord, for the opportunities just to preach the gospel in your name, to lift up the name of Jesus in praise. We're grateful that we can gather here together and do some self-examination. Lord, you ask us to look deep into our own hearts and souls, Lord, and test to whether our faith is genuine. Test to see if there's evidence of the Holy Spirit living within us. Today, Lord, we're doing just that. And we pray that you would open up the hard soils of our heart, Lord, and that you would just plow open that ground, that the Word of God might rest there and live there and be a part of who we are, influencing our lives and helping us to live out the gospel in Jesus' name. Lord, we thank you for everyone that's gathered with us here today. We ask that you would bless them, encourage them, open up their hearts and minds to hear exactly what you have for them to say this morning. We pray it all today in Jesus' name. Amen. Stand and sing this morning. Give God some loud, good singing praise.
Lay them all down in your
Seat as we think about our giving this morning. I want to remind everybody here in person and online that there are safe and secure ways to give here. You can do it online at easytithe.com/wayofhope, or you can do it by text, texting the word give to 814-259-5700. So we encourage you to use those if you can and if you're able to. There's also, you can give here in person, and you can also use our mailing address as well. I do want to share a little bit with you. Yesterday was the auction that we participated in, the Richard Hofecker auction. I want to start by simply saying thank you to everybody for donating all the stuff that you did and all the effort that you put forth for that. We certainly cannot do these things without your help and without your effort. You oftentimes hear me say that good stewardship is using our time and our talents and our treasure for the glory of God. That simply means using your time and your skills and your money. These days, we can also add a little bit more to that. You can also use your voice. That's one of your talents. You can use your time and your skills and your money and your voice to advocate for the church and educate other folks about your faith. We have a great platform nowadays that we can use to continue to share. And I encourage you to network. Use your networking skills. We all have a network nowadays. It's your personal and professional relationships. It's your online following. You all have friends online. And I encourage you to build the kingdom of God and His church. Simply share, share, share. Share the gospel. Help people to know who Jesus is. The auction yesterday is a really great testimony to what good stewardship looks like. We needed people to donate their time. You know, you can donate lots of money, but if you don't donate time, you know, barbecued ham sandwiches don't make themselves. Take somebody to really take and make that sandwich and put the ham on the bread and serve it to the customer. And we also needed talent. I mean, to bake the cakes and to make all that good food and to handle the money and to organize it all and all the things that go involved with that, you know, it takes talent. We also needed some cash, some money, to get started and to buy supplies. All of those things came into play yesterday to make the auction successful for us, for the customers that we were serving, and also for Camp Harmony, where our proceeds are going. So again, thanks to everybody that pitched in and helped make that happen. Now, in terms of the proceeds yesterday, I think it was one of our best auctions ever. I don't keep track of how much, you know, we typically make at auctions, but we had a very good turnout there as far as people coming and donating and eating food. We made $855 yesterday at the auction. So that was awesome. Denise keeps saying it was the best one that we've had. Now, since there was such great support from everybody, here's what I'd like to propose to you today. We made $855 at the auction yesterday. We also had a $200 donation that came to cover supplies. That was kind of seed money. Now, the good news is we really only had about $99 worth of invested in as the church in supplies. So we didn't have a great, you know, expense there as far as that's concerned, which is all because of you and the donations that we got. So here's what I'm proposing. Our proceeds are going to the Camp Harmony to their scholarship fund. And, you know, Phil's here this morning, so Phil's doing the Highmark for Health walk, right? And here's where the money from that goes to, by Phil's own letter from Camp. It says, we're participating in Highmark Walk for a Healthy Community on June the 5th, 2021 in Altoona. This allows us to raise funds for camp scholarships and programming so kids can discover peace, hope, and acceptance and build confidence for whatever challenges the world may have for them. Through a gift to Camp Harmony, you will help provide the necessary funds for use to make an impact on the lives of kids in our camping community. The importance of your generous donation cannot be understated. It will give us the opportunity to provide meals, train staff, create creative activities, outdoor adventures, spiritual guidance, and more to so many kids who wouldn't otherwise have this chance. 100% of your donation comes directly to Camp Harmony and benefits our campers and community. So here's what I'm proposing. We take the $855 that we made at the auction, and we throw in the $200 that we got as a donation for our supplies. That equals $1,055. Is my math good? So far, good. And since I like to round up, as the church, let's just add some and make it a nice round figure of $2,000. Is that good? Can we do that? $2,000. And if it's okay with you, maybe we can throw it at Phil for the Highmark walk as a donation to that, because it all comes back to camp anyway and goes to the scholarship fund and helps camp. So that helps out Phil in raising funds for that too. Is that okay with everybody? We okay with that? Okay, I need head nods, thumbs up for something. It's all because of your giving and constant efforts in that way that we can do it. So $2,000 back to camp for help there, and it's all because of your efforts, more than just giving money, also giving time and using your skills as well. It benefits a lot of things at one time. So we have a lot of reasons to count our blessings and lift up our praise and give thanks to God. When you trust in Him, God's blessings flow back in return. Amen? Let's pray. Father, we thank you again for just the opportunity to be a part of growing the community of faith. Lord, there was a lot of effort, a lot of hard work, a lot of chilly people yesterday that stood around in the auction and worked very hard to raise funds for a very good cause. And Lord, we're grateful for just the excitement that we saw yesterday and all the help that we had and just the resources that we were able to raise. And we're grateful, Lord, that because of your love and support and giving here through the kind folks here, that we're able to add to that and make some impact in kids' lives this summer at camp. So, Father, we're grateful for all of this great privilege and this great work that we can be a part of. And we continue to pray, Lord, that you'll continue to give us guidance as we work to build your kingdom. We pray that you'll continue to encourage people to support the ministry here. We pray that you'll give us discernment as we continue to use what we have here as our resources wisely. Lord, we thank you for the offering today. And again, Lord, we pray that you'll continue to guide us and help us to be the church and to be all that what you call us to be. So, Lord, we give you all the praise today because you are worthy of it. And we thank you, Lord, for each and everyone that gives their time and their talents and their treasure to this ministry and to the building of the kingdom. So, Lord, hear our praises today. We give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. Come and give this morning and sing.
I was blind, now I see any color. I was dead, now I'm living forever. I failed, but you were my redeemer. I've been blessed beyond all measure. I was lost, now I'm found by the Father. I've been changed from the root. I've been given a hope and a future. I've been blessed beyond all measure. I am counting every blessing, counting every blessing, letting go and trusting when I cannot see. I am counting every blessing, counting every blessing, surely every season you are good to. For your goodness, I will ever praise you.
Take some time for some prayer requests this morning, things that you'd like to lift up in prayer. I got a kind of a short list today, actually. So let me start with mine, and then I'll look for yours. Want to keep the Tom Smith family in prayer. This comes from Karen. He passed away earlier this week. So I want to keep the Tom Smith family in prayers for grief in his passing. Also, I want to keep my childhood friend Steve in prayer, who's recovering from colon surgery. I think he's doing okay. I didn't get a current update, but continue to pray for him and his wife Leslie. Also, this comes from Mary Taylor. I want to keep David Bailey in prayer. There's a connection to Mary. Her hubby Chris has a son, and it would be Mary's stepson, and Mary's son, a stepson's granddad, David Bailey. He fell off a ladder and he broke both of his legs at the knees. So please keep David Bailey in prayer. Also, he's having some trouble with breathing problems as well. I want to keep Kayla Trexel in prayer. You know that the daycare she worked at had a COVID connection, so she was on contact quarantine. I think she comes off of that tomorrow, so I think she's tuning in this morning. Good morning, Kayla. But please keep her in prayer and the daycare center there and all the parents that utilize that center. Makes it a little bit tough for everybody. Also, I want to keep those that are dealing with COVID. It's spiking a little bit around through some of our communities and counties. Keep them in prayer as well. Also, George Feathers. I did get a text from Dorothy this morning. I lifted him up last week. He had an MRI as a follow-up from his brain surgery a few months ago. Things seem to be good there. Now they're going to determine what they're going to do for treatment for George. So continue to keep George in prayer. Also, I want to keep Bob Geary in prayer. We've been praying for him. He's online from up in the Clymer way. He's been dealing with prostate cancer and been going through treatments. He had a follow-up with his cancer doctor this week. Things are good, got a good report, and he doesn't have to go back and see the doctor for 4 months. So that's all praise to God for some healing there. So things that you'd like to pray for and lift up. Go ahead, Charlene.
That's my brother-in-law, Keith. He was dealing with cancer that he had, and he had all cleared up practically nothing, and he did an x-ray in December, and he found out now that it's just about all over, and it's now even in his lungs.
Okay. So he had bone cancer is what he started off with, didn't he?
Yeah, like in his lower area, the bladder and everything.
Okay.
Now it's even in his lungs, and he now has hospice coming twice a week. I mean, he's still going to work 2 days a week and do around his yard. He just said the Lord's with him, and
okay, and his last name is
Barnick.
That's right. Okay, so I want to keep Keith Barnick in prayer, who's dealing with cancer, and it seems to be progressing pretty seriously. So please keep Keith in your prayers. Others? Go ahead, Nance.
Crystal Rauch says prayers for Dan. He's considering a new job.
Okay, want to keep Dan Rauch in prayer, who's considering a new job, so good.
And Kayla says, please continue to pray for Steve to find a job here.
Okay, I want to pray for Steve for a new job as well. We've been lifting him up, Steve Kozak, for a while too, for a new job in this area. So pray that he finds the right one. Go ahead, Darlene.
We have a truck driver that can do the work. His name is Russ Butson. He drives the Dunlow, and he, I think it's called a diabetic ulcer, but he had it on the top of his head, like 4 inches.
Okay.
And now he has two real big ones on his neck, and he's like really bad shape.
Okay, I want to keep Russ Butson in prayer, dealing with diabetic ulcers on the head and neck, so I want to keep him in prayer. Good, Tyler, you got one back there too?
Yeah, family and friends of ours, the Earhart family.
Okay.
Lost their little one, Brandon Earhart. He lost his baby, Marin, and it was to suspected shaken baby syndrome.
Okay. The little baby is Brandon. What is it?
Aaron's his name.
Aaron.
Okay. Passed away last night.
Okay. So I want to keep the Dearheart family in prayer. Had the loss of baby Aaron. So, okay. I want to keep that in prayer, certainly. Okay. Anybody else? Go ahead, Phil.
Just a couple of praises. First, for the donation, thank you all for being a part of that. We're going to put that to good use at camp, getting lots of kids to camp and making sure that they have fun and hear about Jesus. But secondly, Jolene and I are celebrating our 13th wedding anniversary this week, so just praise for that.
All right.
Time that we've had together.
All right. Happy anniversary. Want to keep Phil and Jolene both in prayer. 13 years of wedded bliss. Is that right? I don't know. Jolene's head's kind of going. It's not a yes. It's not a no. It's kind of a, hey, we celebrate marriage here. 13 years is something to applaud and praise, because marriage is tough these days. And, you know, marriage is all just wonderful, right? It's perfect. It really is. It's got a lot of ups and downs in it, but it's really good. So we applaud that. Congratulations. Others? Go ahead, Diane. Okay.
She had a very good testimony. Also continue to keep the young man Carlin in prayer. He has been diagnosed with attention deficit and is being put on Ritalin, and the whole family is trying to adjust and are being challenged by the changes in this life.
Okay. So is it Green Walt or
Green a Walt?
Green
a Walt.
Green a Walt. Okay. So I want to keep Emily Greenwald in prayer, who is headed off to the mission field in Cambodia. That's right. And want to keep how old's little Carlin? Just guess.
Around 8 or 10.
Okay. So I want to keep the little young man Carlin in prayer, who is being diagnosed as being ADD, so I want to keep him in our prayers as well. Attention deficit disorder, ADD. Anybody else? Go ahead, Nance.
Kathy Scott says, prayers for Roger. Kidneys are almost back to normal, seeing the heart doctor on Thursday.
Good. Okay, I want to continue to keep Roger Scott in prayer. Had a heart attack, pretty serious one, and been having some kidney issues as well, and they're starting to come back a little more normal. So, morning to Kathy and to Roger. God's blessings to the both of you and to your healing, Roger. So,
she has one more, too.
Go ahead.
Her friend Jeff, his mom has a bad lung disease, and his brother has throat cancer.
Okay, so we want to keep her friend, Jeff's mom, who has lung disease, and what was the other one?
The brother has throat cancer.
And the brother has throat cancer. Okay. So I want to keep both of them in prayer. Jeff's mom and Jeff's brother. Mom has lung disease and the brother has throat cancer. Anybody else? Let's spend some time praying then, silently. I'll close this up and we'll get back to part number two of our message from last week. So join me as we pray. Lord, this morning we're again grateful for the great privilege to be gathered here as the body of Christ. Your scripture reminds us, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. Point out anything in me that offends you, and lead me along the path of everlasting life." Father, during life's testings, you're providing us opportunities to examine our spiritual condition. It is really far too easy for us, Lord, to fall into these faulty assumptions that we make. When we fail, Lord, we often cast blame on somebody else. We blame our circumstances. And sometimes, Lord, we even question your hand in the matter. Lord, we pray that you would give us the courage and thoroughness to turn the searchlight on our own hearts rather than shining the spotlight on somebody else. We invite you, Lord, to bring your spiritual scrub brush, the scrub brush of your holy word, to do the needed cleansing and purging that needs to happen in our lives. Lord, your love is ever before us and will lead us in the way that we should go. It's not by our strength or our power, but it's by walking in your spirit that we can cast out the wrong attitudes and stop all undesirable behavior. Thank you, Lord, for never giving up on us and for your spirit's conviction in our lives. We pray today that again you would open up our hearts and minds to hear your words. Father, we thank you as well for the opportunity to lift up these prayer requests this morning. We thank you for just the good turnout yesterday at the auction. We're grateful, Lord, for all the money that we were able to raise for Camp Harmony and for all the good ministry that they're about. We're grateful to partner with them and be a part of that work. Lord, we continue to ask that you would bless their ministry and bless their staff, and we pray that you would allow this summer season, Lord, to be one of the best as we continue to share the good news about Jesus. We lift up all of these requests today, Lord, and we again ask for you to move in a powerful way. We pray that you would bring your blessings and courage and protection and grace and healing where it's needed. Lord, guide each and every name that has been spoken and those names that have been unspoken. Lord, we praise you and thank you for hearing our prayers this morning. We ask now that you guide us as we preach. In Jesus' name, amen. As I already said, this is actually part two of 10 sins every Christian must bring into the light. We started this actually last week. And we're going to hit part two today. Get a little swallow here. One of the most important conduits that God uses to flow power into our life is your connection to the church. Let me say that again. One of the most important conduits that God uses to flow power into your life is your connection to the church. We should never, ever take that for granted. But here's the catch. You have to plug into the outlets that He provides to access that power. Do you understand? You have a part to play. You have to plug in to that outlet that God provides. When you become actively involved in a Bible-believing church, there are really some benefits for you. It provides the opportunity for you to worship. Worship is simply expressing your gratitude and appreciation to God. And yes, we can worship God individually. We can do that. But worship is best done with other believers corporately. Do you hear what I'm saying? That's why the Bible says that we should not give up meeting together, but encourage one another even more as Jesus' return gets closer. Hebrews 10 and 25. Anybody believe that Jesus isn't returning? Anybody believe that we're not getting closer to Jesus returning? The Bible says that all the more we should not give up meeting together. Church is also the place where you receive instruction from God's Word. Now, personal Bible study is great, and I encourage that. Everybody here should spend time in personal Bible study. But it's no substitute for sitting under the preaching of God's Word. Do you hear me? Like it or not, that's God's plan for spiritual growth. Again, the Bible's clear on this. It says, how will they hear without a preacher? Romans 10 and 4. Now, church is also the place where we receive nourishment through fellowship. It's where hugs and prayers and meals and needs are met. When one Christian has a need, other Christians most often jump in to help meet that need. Amen? Haven't we seen that here? The church is also here to challenge us when we get complacent. And we do get complacent. There's no lie about that. God puts us with other Christians who have spiritual gifts that we don't have so that we can be encouraged by their example and become more like Christ. And then church also encourages us when we get discouraged. When trouble comes, what do we do most often? We pray. We ask for prayer, right? Why? Because we need other Christians to pray for us. We need other Christians to support us and encourage us and counsel us. And we have seen the positive results of prayer happen here time and time again. It's real and it works. The church is also here to correct us when we stray. The way to keep from straying spiritually is to make sure you're around other believers on a regular basis. Listen carefully to me. Once Satan has you isolated, it's much easier for him to attack you and destroy you. When you're plugged into the church, other Christians can watch out for you. That's your team. That's your army, if you will. If they see you starting to drift in your relationship with God, they can lovingly confront you. We are here to challenge and encourage and correct each other so that we can experience the incredible power of the Holy Spirit every day and then use that incredible power to go out and to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with unbelievers. That's what the church is about. That's why Jesus created it. That's why we're here. And that's exactly what we're doing today as we're looking at these 10 sins Christians must bring into light. 1 Peter 4 and 17 says, the time has come for judgment and it must begin with God's household. If we are going to go out into the world to preach and to baptize and to disciple, we need to take a hard look at the sin that's in our own lives. And then we need to do something about it. We can't expect people to follow Jesus if we are not following Jesus ourselves. So as I said, today is actually part two of the message we started last week. And last week we shined the light of Jesus on the first five of the 10 sins. And if you missed it, we want to encourage you to go to our Facebook page or YouTube page and you can catch up on the first five. All you got to do is just Google Way of Hope Christian Fellowship and you should be able to find it real easy. Pops right up. So if you missed the first five, go back and check them out from last Sunday, April the 11th. Now, to quickly recap last week's message, if you're a Christian, we said that failing to love God with all of your heart, all of your soul, all of your mind, and all of your strength is sinful. God wants our total person to be involved in loving Him. That's why Jesus stated it the way that He did. The second one was walking in unbelief. And we said last week that left unchecked, unbelief eventually turns a heart away from believing God's word is truth. We have a great problem with that in our country, our world right now. There's a lot of things that Jesus has said that the Bible says that we don't pay any attention to. We're walking in unbelief. The third was practicing prayerlessness. Our relationship with God really suffers when we do not communicate with Him. We end up living life disconnected from His voice. And I would encourage you never be disconnected from the Lord's voice. The fourth one we talked about last week was living fearfully. We are not to let fear dictate our lives or allow it to lead us in making decisions based on its threat. Hebrews 13 and 6 tells us to say with confidence, "The Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can man do to me?" And then number five last week was the budding roots of bitterness. The Bible was very clear. We are not to let our anger mature into bitterness. Hebrews 12 and 14 says, "Work at living in peace with everyone." Do you hear what it says there? Work at living in peace with everyone. Ephesians 4 and 31 says, "Get rid of all bitterness, rage and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you." Now today we start with number six, and here it is. Wielding wayward words. Now what do I mean by that? In other words, it's using or throwing around naughty, ugly, pervasive, perverse words. It's displaying unruly bad behavior. You understand what wielding wayward words is? It's perverse words, naughty words, unruly behavior. I was in the new medical building on Scalp Avenue this week. Anybody ever been in there yet? The new medical building? Just like this long rectangle building and the front part of it. It's got seating all through it. I've been in there quite frequently over the last year. And the other day the place was packed. I've never seen it with so many people. There was not an empty seat in the waiting area to be had. It was full. And I happened to notice an attractive young lady at the lab window. She was in her mid-20s, I would guess. And she had just driven 2 hours for blood work. And she was being told by the lady behind the window, because I was standing because there wasn't a seat to be had, she was told by this lady that it would be an hour wait for her to be seen to get blood work. And this young lady was rather upset about it. And she started to explain to the lady in the window that she had just driven 2 hours from home, and that if she had to wait, she would be late for work if she had to wait, you know, because it was a two-hour drive back home. She was really frustrated about the whole thing. And so she walked down the hall behind me to call somebody to complain to. And about every third word out of her mouth was the F word, followed by lots of other profane words. Now, whoever was on the other end of the phone was apparently trying to calm her down, but she wasn't having none of it. Needless to say, she was wielding a lot of wayward words. Do you understand what I'm saying? And she was displaying some unruly bad behavior. And unfortunately, her outer attractiveness was overshadowed by her inner ugliness and her perverse words and her unruly bad behavior. It really ruined her countenance, if you know what I mean. Now, I don't know if she was a Christian or not. What I do know is this. Christians need to be mindful of what comes out of their mouth. It can either confirm for you or undermine your witness. Whether it's complaining or calling others out or using coarse language, it seems like today that more and more Christians are less and less concerned about what comes out of their mouths. I suppose maybe they're more interested in coming across edgy and relevant than godly. But Ephesians chapter 5, verses 3 and 4 reminds us that this kind of reckless speech has no place in our lives. Look at it in Ephesians 5. Let there be no sexual immorality, impurity, or greed among you. Such sins have no place among God's people. Obscene stories, foolish talk, and coarse jokes, these are not for you. Instead, let there be thankfulness to God. Colossians 4, verses 5 and 6 urges us to live wisely among those who are not believers, and make the most of every opportunity. Let your conversation be gracious and attractive, seasoned with salt, so that you will have the right response for everyone. Now, I want you to notice here, our conversation is supposed to be what? Gracious and attractive, right? If you're reading the New International Version or New King James Version, it says in there also, seasoned with salt. That means that we're to add flavor to the conversation, not be salty and talk like a drunken frat boy. Does that make sense? Ephesians chapter 4 and 29 says, don't use foul or abusive language. Let everything you say be good and helpful, so that your words will be an encouragement to those who hear them. It would have been difficult for that young lady to turn around after I overheard her conversation on the phone, for her to witness to me and tell me how much of a godly Christian she was. Now, perhaps you've been caught off guard by something you heard a Christian say. Maybe you've surprised yourself with some of the things that have come out of your mouth. If so, James chapter 1 and 26 cautions us. It says, if you claim to be religious, but don't control your tongue, you're fooling yourself. And your religion is worthless. I'd have had a hard time with a young lady trying to witness to me after what I heard her on the phone. Jesus himself said to the crowd in Matthew 15 and 10, he says, it's not what you put in your mouth that makes you unholy. It's what comes out of your mouth. I like the way the message states it. It's not what you swallow that pollutes your life. but what you vomit up. That dear young lady was vomiting up chunks, and they were flying everywhere. Number 7 is looking for attention or recognition. Now, what we're talking about here is an individual that routinely solicits attention through inappropriate means or to an excessive degree. You got that? Somebody who routinely solicits attention either through inappropriate means or to an excessive degree. The guy who lies to his friends in order to make himself more interesting. The woman who calls herself fat in hoping of sparking a compliment. A person that claims no one likes them as they sit among a crowd of people waiting for someone to convince them otherwise. These are just a few examples of seeking recognition. Whatever the cost, these characters have to be the center of attention. They don't even care about embarrassing themselves. They just want to get more attention on them, whether it's negative or positive, as long as all eyes are on them. I remember John Mangus telling me a story one time from New Day about a young man in Johnstown that was caught lighting dumpsters on fire. And he grew up in a single-parent home without a father. And they couldn't figure out why this kid kept lighting these dumpsters on fire, because he'd light dumpsters on fire and then he'd just go a few feet away and he'd sit down and wait for the police and the firemen to come. And he did it over and over and over again. And finally, John got to the bottom of it. He had no male attention in his life. And what happened when he set the dumpster on fire? Policemen and firemen came. And he had all the male attention that he could possibly stand at one time. So he set dumpsters on fire to get attention, male attention, fatherly attention. Sadly, many Christians are looking for recognition from people rather than doing things for the joy of pleasing God. Self-promotion today is the way of the world. Everybody has to have a brand. Everybody has to have a platform. Everybody has to brag about how good they are, how perfect their life is. And social media offers everyone a place to seek attention or recognition and fish for likes. But here's what the Bible says about that. Proverbs 27:2 says, "Let someone else praise you, not your own mouth. A stranger, not your own lips." Jesus warned of seeking your own recognition in Matthew chapter 6:1. He says, "Be careful not to do your acts of righteousness before men, to be seen by them. If you do, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven." In other words, don't make a show out of yourself. Your internet friends may be applauding you and telling you all the nice things that you think are nice, but the God who made you won't be applauding. It's vital that we examine our motives. Is what we're doing meant to be seen and recognized by others, or are what we doing, is it to serve and please God? One is sinful and one is not. When you call attention to yourself, Jesus said you're receiving all the reward you're going to get. When you live quietly and modestly, your Heavenly Father knows your secrets and He will reward you, Matthew chapter 6:6. And then here's number 8. Christians need to deal with the sin of cultivating competitiveness. Now, again, stay with me. Competitiveness that we're talking about here is possessing a strong desire to be more successful than others. Unfortunately, today, many Christians are competing with their spouses. They're competing with their siblings. They're competing with their coworkers and their neighbors and who knows who else. Now, let me be clear about this. Competitiveness is not necessarily sinful. Okay? Listen, I like to win, too. Ask Owie. We shoot together. I like to always beat him at shooting. I don't even feel bad about that at all, do I, Owie? He beat me last week, though, and he let me know about it. So, I'm just saying. So, competitiveness is not necessarily sinful. But actively seeking to prove superiority over others leads to sinfulness. James 3 and 16 says, wherever there is jealousy and selfish ambition, that's what we're talking about here, there you will find disorder and every evil of every kind. And it's true. Jealousy and selfish ambition have caused decent people to do some terrible stuff. Am I telling you the truth? It's true. If you go back into the Old Testament to 1 Samuel 18, you'll find a great illustration of this very point. King Saul was competitive with David. And he was fearful of the people starting to love David more than himself. 1 Samuel 18, starting in verse 6, says, when the victorious Israelite army was returning home after David had killed the Philistine, women from all the towns of Israel came out to meet King Saul. They sang and danced for joy with tambourines and cymbals. This was their song. Saul has killed his thousands, and David his 10,000s. This made Saul very angry. What's this, he said. They credit David with 10,000s and me with only thousands. Next, they'll be making him their king. So from that time on, Saul kept a jealous eye on David. Now, tragically, King Saul's competitiveness led him to seek David's life. He literally set out to kill him. Now, he wasn't successful, but it really made Saul do some crazy stuff. Setting out to prove yourself superior to others is really a fruitless waste of time. Ecclesiastes 4 and 4 gives us some good advice about this. It says, most people are motivated to success because they envy their neighbors. But this too is what? Meaningless. Like chasing the wind. Envying your neighbor is rather stupid and meaningless. Rather than competing with each other, God calls us to love one another. Romans 12:9 says, love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Honor one another above what? Yourselves. That will keep you from sinning and falling into the competitiveness trap. And here's sin number 9. It's reveling in rebelliousness. Now, reveling in rebelliousness is delighting or celebrating in disobedience, defiance, and insubordination. It's really just partying it up and giving it little thought. Now, rebelliousness is pretty much a touchy subject because most often Christians don't want to consider the possibility that some of their thoughts and attitudes and actions might be rooted in disobedience towards God. We make a lot of justifications for the things we do in life. And yet there are many Christians who are enjoying worldly behaviors and pleasing their own desires over yielding to God. Instead of submitting to his words and ways, we justify, we rationalize our choices, and we're very unwilling to bring them under the light of God's truth. 1 Peter 1:13 urges us to live as obedient children. It says, therefore, prepare your minds for action. Be self-controlled. That's a huge thing. One of the fruits of the Spirit, too, by the way. Self-control. I think we have a little problem with that in our world today. Set your hope fully on the grace to be given you when Christ, Jesus Christ is revealed. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance. But just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, be holy because I am holy. Now, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on rebellion because number 10 really illustrates number 9. And number 10, I think, is an even bigger point here today. And here it is. It's entertaining sexual immorality. Unfortunately, a growing number of Christians are comfortable with sexual immorality, despite what Ephesians 5 and 3 says. Let's go back and look at it again. It says, let there be no sexual immorality, impurity, or greed among you. Such sins have no place among God's people. There are a lot of Christians that enjoy viewing inappropriate sexual relationships. They overlook its sinfulness and justify their indulgence in it. Why? Because they love the characters, they love the storylines, they love all of that stuff more than they love God. And I can prove it to you. Isn't it funny that we want to cancel Dr. Seuss and Looney Tunes and Mr. Potato Head because they are offensive? But Cardi B and Megan Thee Stallion's filthy and pornographic performance of her song WAP at the Grammy Awards last month on primetime TV is somehow okay. Do you know what I'm talking about? Know what I'm talking about? If you have no idea what I'm talking about, here's a little clue. They were both straddling each other and writhing about on the stage floor made out to be this huge bed while belting out all the ultra raunchy lyrics that discuss female pleasure using explicit sexual descriptions. You want to know what the song? Well, I shouldn't even tell you to go Google it, but the song lyrics are absolutely wretched. Following its release in August 2020, the tune went to the top Billboard 100 chart for 4 weeks. Number one. And now it's hit platinum as a single 5 times. When you hit platinum in the record business, that means you've sold 2 million copies. They've done that 5 times. That means they've sold over 10 million copies already since August of 2020. And several publications have already named it the song of the year. And I would be willing to bet that a lot of Christians own it and listen to it. 1 John 2 and 16 clarifies where this stuff comes from. He says, for everything in the world, the cravings of sinful man, the lust of his eyes, and the boasting of what he has and does, comes not from the Father, but from the world. And verse 17 gives us the caution and the hope. It says, the world and its desires pass away, but the man who does the will of God lives forever. Now I'm really going to step into you this morning as we wrap up. You're either going to be really mad or it's really going to make you think. You know what the largest church in America is today? Want to guess? It's the movie theater. It's Hollywood. It's the media. I want to show you a movie clip from a great movie that Denise and I watched recently, and I encourage you to rent it. The title is Power of the Air. And here's a little bit about the movie and the storyline before I show you the clip. It's an independent Christian movie, and it was written by David Cristiano, and it was produced by 5&2 Productions. And it's about the power of Hollywood and the media and how it affects your life. And the storyline is about a missionary from Africa that comes to the United States and shares with a concerned Christian how he feels the church in America is being deceived and is in great danger. You ready to watch the clip? Just hang on a minute. Let me make sure that you can hear it. Maybe it's time we started a revolution, huh? Watching sexual immorality deeply affects our hearts and minds in adverse ways. If we as Christians think that we can watch it and remain unaffected, we're simply just being deceived. It affects how we think, it affects how we live, it affects how we make decisions, it affects how we view sin, and most importantly, it affects our relationship with God. Psalm 101 in verse 3, I should say, offers direction for our eyes. It says, I will not look with approval on anything that is vile. I hate what faithless people do. I will have no part in it. And Jesus was even tougher when it comes to what we allow ourselves to look at. In Matthew 5:29, he says, if your right eye causes you to sin, gouge it out and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one part of your body than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. Now, I don't know if any of these sins that we've talked about over the last 2 weeks affect your life. I don't know. And then again, maybe they all do. If I was a gambling man, I would bet that some of them do. All I know is this. 1 Peter 4:17 says, the time has come for judgment, and it must begin with God's household. It's time for us to evaluate these things in our lives and root out these sins if they've taken up residence in our being. Failing to love God, walking in unbelief, practicing prayerlessness, living fearfully, letting your anger mature into bitterness, wielding wayward words, looking for recognition and attention, cultivating competitiveness, reveling in rebelliousness, and entertaining sexual immorality. All of these sins affect the Christian's witness and effectiveness. As Hebrews 12 says, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up, and let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. I don't know what you have to do with all of this in your life, but I've set the challenge out before you. It is time for the church to evaluate itself and be the people that God has called it to be. Amen? Let's stand and sing.
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil. I'm
Cake over there on the table. It was left over from the auction yesterday. There are also some buns and things over there, I believe, as well. So please make the cake disappear today. We got to make sure that it evacuates the building. So take some with you on the way home. If you'd like to make a donation, we'll make sure that that gets to Camp Harmony. But make sure that the cake and the rolls, at least the buns, vacate their way out of here today. Everybody good with that? Don't leave here without cake. Okay? You got your cake? Yeah, that's perfect. And eat it too. That's right. Anything else we need to know for the good of the order? Just as God's word was sent into the world to heal and redeem, so God sends you into the world this day to be light and love, healing and hope. Go now to be the light of the world, and may the grace and peace of God the Creator, the Redeemer, and the Sustainer come upon you this day and remain with you always. Go in peace and go with God's blessing. Amen. Thanks for joining us today here in person and online. Hope to see you back here next Sunday, 10 a.m., God's blessings until then. Amen.